Chapter 5, Hot Packs. On my first day in the new room, I grumped to Dr. Beavis that the worst part of being paralyzed was that I couldn't paint my toenails. What good, I asked, was a life without painted toenails? I don't know what made me say such a thing, since I had never painted my toenails before I got sick. Maybe I just wanted handsome Dr. Beavis to notice me. The next day, Dr. Beavis marched into my room and whisked the covers off my feet. Without saying a word, he took a bottle of bright red nail polish out of his pocket. I was astonished. "Where did you get nail polish?" I asked. "I bought it." "Why?" "My favorite patient says life is no good without painted toenails." He sat beside me and painted each of my toenails. I felt like a princess. He had bought nail polish just for me. Page 45. I was his favorite patient. Instantly, I developed a serious crush on Dr. Beavis. When he finished, he said, "Now I want you to do something for me." At that moment, I would have flung myself off the Golden Gate Bridge if he had asked me to. "What do you want?" I asked, wondering what I could do for him in my condition. "I want you to get well. Someday, I want to watch you walk." He looked directly into my eyes. "Will you do that for me?" "Yes." "Good," he said. "It would make me very happy." I promised him and myself that I would do it. Somehow, some way, I would get well. I would walk for this man who had painted my toenails. For days, I insisted that the nurses let my feet stick out from under the blankets so I could admire my beautiful toenails. Dr. Beavis's visits quickly became the highlights of every day. I tried to remember every knock-knock joke I'd ever heard, so I would have something to tell him. I wanted to make him laugh, and I also hoped to make him stay in my room longer. Page 46. When I couldn't remember any more knock-knock jokes, I began to make them up. I spent hours thinking of puns and figuring out ways to use them. My favorite was, "Knock, knock. Who's there?" "Wendy." "Wendy who?" "Wendy, toenails are painted. The patient gets well." Dr. Beavis groaned, but I could tell he liked it. Tommy liked it, too. I asked my parents for a radio, because I missed hearing my favorite program, The Lone Ranger. They bought a small portable radio, and at 6:30 that night, I asked one of the nurses to tune in The Lone Ranger for me. As soon as the familiar theme song began, Tommy let out a whoop of glee. "Oh, boy," he cried, "we get to hear The Lone Ranger." He said he used to listen to every broadcast before he got sick. The nurse placed the radio between my bed and Tommy's iron lung so we could both hear. When our hero yelled to his horse, "Hi-yo, Silver, away!" Tommy and I yelled, too. Page 47. From then on, I called Tommy Tonto, the name of Lone Ranger's companion, and he called me Kemosabe, which means faithful friend. We sometimes listened to music, too, or the Archie Andrews show, but we could hardly wait for 6:30 on Mondays, Wednesdays, and Fridays so we could hear The Lone Ranger. It felt good to have something to look forward to again. We could not look forward to a fast recovery, for there was no medicine for polio. The doctors hoped to minimize its effects, however, with the Sister Kenny treatments. These treatments, named for Sister Elizabeth Kenny, the Australian nurse who first used them, consisted of two parts. The first was hot packs, and I had begun getting these twice a day in isolation as soon as my fever broke. For this part of the treatment, I lay on my stomach, dressed only in underpants. Because my shoulder muscles were so weak, a rolled-up towel was put under each shoulder to keep them from becoming too rounded. Then a nurse wheeled a big metal tank filled with steaming water up to my bed. The wheels squeaked and rattled across the floor as she approached, sounding like a freight train approaching its station. Page 48. She put large gray woolen cloths in the hot water and then lifted them out with tongs so she wouldn't burn her fingers. She flattened the cloths in a wringer attached to the side of the tank, removing most of the moisture. The steam from the cloths filled my nostrils. I grew to dread the smell of wet wool. As the hot cloths came out of the wringer, the nurse laid them across my bare back and the backs of my legs and arms. The first time I had a hot PAX treatment, I thought the nurse had made a mistake and heated the water too high. It felt like the hot PAX were burning all the skin off. I screamed and cried, even though the nurse assured me that I wasn't being scalded. She said the water had to be that hot in order to help me. After a few minutes, as the hot PAX began to cool, they felt good, because the warm, moist heat helped my tight muscles relax. When the cloths cooled to lukewarm, they were removed, and a fresh batch of hot PAX were laid across my back, arms, and legs. This went on for an hour, with the nurse taking the steaming cloths from the hot water, wringing them out, and plunking them on my bare skin. Page 49. Each time a cold cloth was removed, I closed my eyes and braced myself for the next searing moments of the next hot one. The backs of my thighs were particularly tender, and every time a hot pack was laid there, I was sure my skin was being blistered and burned. On my second day of treatment, I asked, "How many times do I have to get hot packs?" I thought the hot packs were like medicine. Take 2 times a day for 7 days, and then it would be over. "Oh, the hot packs continue as long as you're here," the nurse said, as she plucked another steaming cloth from the boiling water. That could be weeks, I thought, months even. "Of course," she continued, "hot packs are only one part of the Kenny treatment. As soon as you're out of isolation, you'll get the second part." Page 50.